U.S. President Joe Biden again appealing to those in the path of Hurricane Milton to flee to safety. Biden also condemns those spreading disinformation about the storm, calling it un-American to undermine federal and rescue team efforts.
Over the last few weeks, there's been reckless and irresponsible and relentless promotion of disinformation and outright lies about what's going on. It's undermining confidence in the people in Florida. Milton still carries incredible destructiveness, can wipe out communities, can cause loss of life. Storm surge is still expected to be up to 13 feet. So I urge everyone in Hurricane Milton's path to listen to local officials and follow all the safety instructions they give. At this point, evacuation is probably difficult. So I encourage people to look for safer shelter. Sometimes moving just a few miles can mean the difference between life and death.
The American leader also warning companies against taking advantage of the victims of Hurricane Milton. Biden says his administration will apply pressure to keep prices stable so that people can access gasoline, flights, and other necessary goods without overpaying.
Moments like this, there are no red or blue states. There's one United States of America where neighbors are helping neighbors. Volunteers and first responders are risking everything, including their own lives, to help their fellow Americans. State, local, and federal officials are standing side by side. Let me repeat, no one should make the American people question whether their governments will be making sure that this disaster when it strikes, they'll be there.
Over in the U.S., dangerous winds rage across Florida, coupled with multiple tornadoes ahead of Hurricane Milton's landfall. ABS-CBN's North America Bureau is monitoring the powerful storm. Our correspondent, Henny Espinosa, has the story.
Hey guys, here are news making headlines for Filipinos in North America. All eyes are on Florida as Hurricane Milton, described as an extremely dangerous Category 4 storm, is forecast to make landfall near Tampa, Florida, late Wednesday or early morning on Thursday, and move east-northeast central Florida thereafter. Millions of residents along more than 300 miles of coastline are under evacuation orders, and officials warn people they need to take this seriously.
You need to prepare for catastrophic impacts.
As of Wednesday morning, the eye of the storm was 250 miles southwest of Tampa, driving sustained winds of 145 miles per hour. The region, still reeling from the aftermath of Hurricane Helene 2 weeks ago, could see life-threatening storm surges, damaging winds, and heavy rainfall. Floridians are in panic buying mode, with many gas stations running out of fuel for those fleeing for safety.
What we see from these storms is that the majority of the fatalities come from the storm surge, come from the water.
More than 12 million people were also under tornado warnings. This video was taken by Brendan Flores outside his home in Sarasota, Florida, Wednesday afternoon. Flores is the national chair of the National Federation of Filipino American Associations, or NAFA.
You can really get a sense of the size and power of the storm from what we're experiencing now, as you can see. This hurricane is quite unique because of its path. It's cutting across the state. Airports are shut down, gas stations are dry, and traffic is gridlocked, which made it so challenging for many to evacuate. So I'm excited to stay, not just due to these challenges, but also to be here for our community.
It may be too late for Flores and other Sarasota residents to evacuate. The National Weather Service says, as of Wednesday afternoon, it is time to shelter in place. FEMA urges those who stayed behind to continue to listen to local officials for further direction. Florida Governor Ron DeSantis sent them this stern warning.
Now, if you are in an evacuation zone and you're in places like Sarasota or Charlotte, just know that if you get 10 feet of storm surge, you can't just hunker down with that. That is ultimately the surge. Mother Nature is going to win that fight.
In this time of disaster, Filipino essential workers in Florida are ready to put in the hours and do their jobs, even if it means risking their lives. Some hospitals have put up protective barriers that can withstand storm surges up to 15 feet above sea level. Emilio Cruz shares that his wife, a patient care technician, and two daughters, both nurses, are committed to keep working.
Yung sa eldest daughter ko kasi, she's actually working at North Bay Hospital. And since yung North Bay na yan is mandatory evacuation, they have to transfer in Wesley Chapel. Yung second daughter ko naman, yung youngest, sa St. Anthony in St. Petersburg.
Nurse Erin Arcelia, who lives in Pasco County, is preparing to work long hours to care for his patients.
For the whole duration of the storm, I am expecting that I'll be working in the hospital. And part of only the preparations that I am making is to make sure that the house and my personal items are secured during the storm and that I have enough supplies to last for maybe a good week, because I am expecting power outages after the storm.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.
U.S. President Joe Biden and Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu hold a phone call as tensions rise in the Middle East. It was the first known talk between the two leaders since August. The call also coincides with a sharp escalation of Israel's conflict with Iran and Hezbollah. The White House says the call was very direct, acknowledging the two have disagreements and are open about them. The Middle East has been on edge, awaiting Israel's response to a missile attack last week that Tehran carried out in retaliation for Israel's military escalation in Lebanon.
Let me just give you a couple of just top lines on the call. It lasted about 30 minutes. It was 30 minutes long. It was direct. It was productive, obviously, the call that the president had with the prime minister of Israel. So as you all know, the U.S. and the Israeli government have been discussing, have had discussion since last week. Since after the Iran attack. And so that those discussions continued with the president and the prime minister.
Israel's ambassador to the UN, Danny Danon, criticizing Hezbollah's call for a ceasefire as it continues its attacks on civilians. Danon says the Iran-backed group must stop targeting Israel and withdraw.
If Hezbollah wants the situation to de-escalate, it's very simple. They have to do two things. First, they must immediately stop shelling our civilian communities. Second, Hezbollah must withdraw to the north of the Litani River in accordance with UN Resolution 1701, which was adopted here in the Security Council in 2006.
Meanwhile, the top UN official in Lebanon, pushing for a way to enforce a UN Security Council resolution, violated for years by both sides. A UN peacekeeping mission is mandated by the resolution to help the Lebanese army keep its southern border area with Israel free of weapons or armed personnel other than those of the Lebanese state. The official also says the U.S. and French-led call for a 21-day truce remains on the table.
We need a realistic roadmap for the implementation by both sides of United Nations Security Council Resolution 1701. And this must include clear implementation and enforcement mechanisms. At the end of the day, it is the lack or non-implementation even of Resolution 1701 over the past 18 years that led to today's harsh reality.
The Philippine president ordering cabinet officials to prepare for the evacuation of Filipinos from Lebanon. But he stopped short of placing the conflict-torn country under Alert Level 4, which calls for mandatory repatriation. Marcos squeezed in a virtual meeting with several cabinet members from Laos as Israel and Hezbollah continue to exchange attacks. His marching order utilized all assets to bring home hundreds of Filipinos stuck in the Middle Eastern country.
Let's make all the preparations so that nakamalapit na lahat ng asset natin. Kung may barko tayong kukunin, nandyan na malapit na sa Beirut na sandali lang. Basta the embassy gives us the all clear and they say that our people can go, mailabas na agad natin so that hindi sila nag-aantay na matagal in a danger area.
As of October 8, over 1,700 Filipinos in Lebanon have applied for repatriation. Around 500 have already returned to Manila. A migrant workers group in the Middle East urging the Philippine government to be more proactive and to order the mandatory repatriation of Filipinos in Lebanon.
Marami tayong mga nakakausap sa Lebanon na paulit-ulit na sila nagpupunta sa embassy, pero ang binabanggit sa kanila, magpalista lamang sila. Pero marami rin sa mga kababayan natin na nasa southern part ng Lebanon na kung saan nandun yung bombahan ngayon, ang hindi na talaga makalabas ng kanilang mga bahay. At tumatawag sila sa OWA, sa DMW, at saka sa embassy, ang laging binabanggit sa kanila ay standby lang. Pero ang marami sa kanila ay nanghihingi na ng rescue. Sa tinatakbo ng bagal ng repatriation, yung mga nasa shelter, ilang linggo na sila, buwan na doon. Tingin namin dapat hindi na maghintay yung ating national government doon sa mga private flights. Kailangan talagang magkaroon ng mga chartered flights.
U.S. scientists David Baker and John Jumper and Briton Demis Hassabis win the 2024 Nobel Prize in Chemistry for their work in decoding the structure of proteins. Half the prize was shared by Hassabis and Jumper for protein structure prediction, and the other half was awarded to Baker for computational protein design. Hassabis and Jumper utilized artificial intelligence to predict the structure of almost all known proteins, while Baker learned how to create entirely new proteins. Their work has yielded advances in areas such as drug development.
Yeah, well, we've won it for building a system called AlphaFold that solves a long-standing problem in biology, a 50-year kind of grand challenge. Proteins are what everything in life depends on, and it's really important to understand how the structure of a protein, the 3D structure of protein, looks like in the body to understand what it does.
And the Nobel is about celebrating the science that really, really matters to people, and saying that, you know, today and now AI is changing science. And I think it's just such an incredible and prestigious prize, and I absolutely can't believe, you know, how quickly they've seen fit to give it to us. I think it's exceptional.